नमस्कार, स्वागत है आप सभी का एनसीईआरटी के लाइव फोन इन कार्यक्रम में। साइंस की इस क्लास में हम बातचीत करेंगे व्हाई डू वी फॉल इल। दिस इज वन ऑफ द चैप्टर्स इन नाइन्थ क्लास एंड दिस इज द फोर्थ पार्ट ऑफ द सेम चैप्टर। इफ यू हैव नॉट सीन द अर्लियर थ्री सेशंस देन प्लीज वॉच देम ऑन आर यूट्यूब चैनल एनसीईआरटी ऑफिशियल। इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस रिगार्डिंग द सेम चैप्टर व्हाई डू वी फॉल इल, इफ यू वांट टू नो अबाउट सर्टेन डिसीजेस कॉजेस एंड कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस एंड सम डाइट एनीथिंग एंड एवरीथिंग रिलेटेड टू दिस टॉपिक देन प्लीज रीच अस एंड सेंड योर क्वेश्चंस ऑन आर ईमेल आईडी व्हिच इज dth.class9@cit.nic.in. You're watching us live on PME Vidya channel number 9 as well as on our YouTube channel NCERT Official. You can also write down your questions in the live chat box of our YouTube channel. And our expert, she'll be more than happy to take all those questions, all those queries. If you want to know about the details of our programs scheduled for this week, for next week, then please visit our website, that is Swayamprabha NCIET. There you'll get the entire schedule, all the details of our programs from timings to topics, from subjects to classes. All right, apart from this, let me tell you that at 4 o'clock we are going to come back with a panel discussion on digital games for education, and at 5 o'clock we'll come back with our special program Sahyog, where we'll discuss the topic healthy thinking for happy life. Let's meet our expert for this particular session where we are going to discuss the topic. Let me say again, why do we fall ill? We have Dr. Priyanka Varshney. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Tanvi, ma'am. How are you?
I'm great, ma'am. How are you doing?
I'm good too.
So, ma'am is an assistant professor from Lady Irwin College, Delhi University, New Delhi. So, let's ask ma'am that what exactly did we learn in the third part and hum aaj kya padhne wale hain? Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Tanvi, ma'am. Hello, everyone. All students, I'm sure you are healthy and you are doing good. So, students, as Tanvi ma'am has just said, that we are going to discuss today the chapter of why do we fall ill. And this discussion is a part two of our discussions. Before that, I have had three sessions in which I have tried to discuss different aspects of the same chapter. For a quick review of what we have done in the previous sessions, you can have a look. We have discussed the broad concept and significance of health. We have talked about the distinction between healthy and disease-free. We have talked about disease and its various causes. And we have also discussed what is the difference between the acute and chronic disease. Apart from that, in my last session, I have also discussed the concept of infectious and non-infectious diseases. I have also talked about the concept of antibiotics and the precautions which we need to take when we are taking antibiotics for any particular disease. And I had also talked about the means of spread of various diseases. So students, these are the major, I would say, subtopics which were covered in the previous sessions. For the sake of ease, I have noted down and I have released the title of my talks, which you can refer, as I have said, on the YouTube channel. The first was broad concept of health and its significance. The second discussion was with the title disease and its causes. And the third was why do we call this part 2. So this session is going to be the last part, part 4, where we will try to sum up the discussion, related discussion of the chapter. Let's move ahead. So the major focus of discussion today, students, will be organ-specific and tissue-specific manifestations of various diseases. We will talk about the principles of treatment. We will talk about the principles of prevention, and we will also be talking about the concept of immunization. So first, let's talk about what is organ-specific and tissue-specific manifestations of various diseases. So students, as we know it, that when any infectious agent is entering into our body, then we have certain signs and symptoms and manifestations, and by that we come to know that something is there which is not well with our body and we need to attend to that. So that is the first signal that we get about any disease. Now, how do we know that probability of having a particular disease is there? It depends on two things. One is to which group that particular organism is belonging, we have already known in our previous sessions, there might be bacteria, there might be viruses, there might be protozoa, there might be fungus, there might be worms, like Kelvin spore. So the route they will be taking to enter the body also is related with the symptoms and signs that we will get. So any disease causing microbe that it is entering the body, there are the places and the organs where it goes. And after that, we have seen over a long period of time that certain groups, certain microorganisms have been found to be developing and evolving into certain organs of our body. So it gives us an indication of what kind of disease we may have. For example, if there is an entry through the nose, some microorganism, for example, virus or bacteria, is entering through the nose, then the likely symptoms that we will see, the signs that we will get from the lungs. For example, common cold, COVID-19 pandemic. So in COVID-19 pandemic, it is widely said and shared that we have to cover our nose and mouth. Because there are higher chances that a COVID-19 virus may enter inside the body through the nose. So when it enters through the nose, we have seen the cases if COVID-19 infection has been a little uncontrolled. Like for example, 5, 6 and 7 days have passed and we have realized that we have been infected by COVID-19. Then there have been impacts on the lungs. During the testing in the lungs, it has been found that many of the people had developed pneumonia and there was coughing, there was other related symptoms which are indicating the place of multiplication of virus is lungs. Similar is the case with tuberculosis. Tuberculosis bacteria, it is entering through the nose, then it affects our lungs. So these are the examples we can see that if the route of entry inside the body is through the nose, then affected organ is likely to be lungs. Similarly, if some microorganism is entering our body through mouth, then the chances it will go inside the esophagus, our gut lining, and then it may develop there. It has been the case in typhoid bacteria. We have seen typhoid bacteria to be developing inside our gut. Or it may be, for example, the hepatitis virus. The virus is responsible for jaundice. Entering through the mouth, it reaches to liver and there it multiplies. And it leads to jaundice. So the route of entry is also signaling a lot the presence, the probability of presence of that particular microorganism in our body. But this is not the route. Apart from that, we have seen like in case of malaria. Malaria is spread by biting the Anopheles mosquito, the female Anopheles mosquito. So it bites, and when it is sucking the blood from our body, at the same time this is injecting the protozoa parasite in our body. And this parasite goes first into the liver, then RBC, it has a whole complex cycle. So it spreads throughout the body. We can also see the case of HIV virus, which causes the disease known as AIDS. It may be because of unprotected sexual contact. It may be because of usage of infected injection, the needle. It may be passed on from mother to the child to breastfeeding. But once it enters the body, it goes through all the lymph nodes of our body. So it spreads and it weakens the immune system. So we can see there are different ways through which these microorganisms are entering in our body, and then there are specific sites where they start multiplying, replicating themselves to cause the disease. Now, students, if we talk about the signs and symptoms of various diseases, so as I said, there are multiple specific sites where they tend to multiply. So for example, if the site of multiplication of the microorganism is lungs, then we may see the symptoms like coughing and breathlessness. So lungs are directly related to the process of respiration. If there is an infection of microorganism, for example, if common cold is there, if influenza is there, pneumonia is there, COVID-19 virus infection is there, then we see these symptoms of cough and breathlessness because the infection site is lungs. Now, if you see if the infection site is liver, then we see the signs and symptoms like jaundice. We see the color of the eye, the skin becomes pale in color. So that is again the signs and symptoms are related to the organ which is affected. Apart from that, if the site of infection and the multiplication of microorganisms is brain, then we will see the symptoms like headache, vomiting, fits, unconsciousness, because all these things are controlled by the brain. And if brain is the site of multiplication of that microbe, then we see the signs something is there in the body which is not fine, which is not there, there is a probability of cellular disease, but we need to be cautious. Signs and symptoms do not 100% ensure that which is the causative agent. For example, if I have headache, the headache may be because I am stressed about my examinations. It was a long, tiring day. I did a lot of work. I am very tired. And because of that, I am having headache. So the simple reason is doing a lot of work. If I take rest, if I sleep for some time, I will be fine. But at the same time, headache may be because of some infection in the brain, meningitis, other issues. So first signs and symptoms are the indication of telling us that something is not good with us, something is not which is ensuring our health. There is a possibility of having the disease. The next step is getting it tested. The entire repertoire of the tests which are available for identification of specific probable myocardium. So this is where it is very important that first of all, if something is not correct with the signs and symptoms, if I am not feeling healthy, if some signs are there, I need to be alert and we need to visit the doctor and we need to get tested for the same. Apart from that, we have seen that there are also indications of having an infection like inflammation. For example, if you have pimples or if some local skin infection is there, then we see that some redness is there surrounding the area and some boil is there and that boil pus might be there and some red skin might be there. This is known as inflammation. And some pain is also there in that area. Redness is there, some pus may or may not be there and pain is there. What is the indication? The indication is that some infection has happened in my skin and my defense system, which is also known as immune system, is acting against it to kill or control that microorganism. For example, if I have some bacterial infection, then after a certain point of time, this infection is not controlled, the bacteria will multiply and then it might lead to the inflammation because my defense system, the immune system of my body will come into play. It will call out the specific cells which are known as fighter cells. These are known as B cells and T cells. There are specific names for that. And they come reach to the side and they start fighting off the bacteria. And that leads to the swelling of redness and sometimes if it is happening in the region of pus. So this is also one of the indications of telling us that there might be some issue, some disease might be there, some problem might be there. And apart from these specific indications, for example, see the boil, inflammation on the skin, there might be general indications also that sometimes we see that we get fever. There is some infection because of that fever. So this is the general body temperature. The reason may be one, that it is happening to one organ of the body, but I am getting fever. So this is also one of the general signs. So this is, I would say, the repertoire of the signs and symptoms that we get. But apart from that, students, this one point I would say, this is very important for us to realize, every infection is not leading to disease. So it's not that I have been exposed to some bacteria, virus or some other fungus for that matter, then certainly I am going to develop the disease. This is not, there is no direct relationship. Why? The reason is that, as I just mentioned, our body has a defense system. There are certain cells which are there inside our body. These are helping us in fighting these various infections and disease. And they form the entire system, which is known as the immune system of the body. This So this system is there. So if some infection is happening at the preliminary level, the body tries to control it and ward it off then and there. Then it does not get converted into the disease. But because of many reasons, if my immunity is low, if it is compromised, I do not have strong immunity, then in that case, my body is not able to fight the infection and that will lead to the causing of disease. So, one thing is that we need to have strong immunity system. And of course, as we have talked about in our previous classes, this is not something in isolation with other factors. It is related to my socio-cultural, economic and the social surrounding. And of for my educational awareness about the same. For example, if I am not consuming nutritious diet, then of course my immunity will be compromised. If the pure drinking water is not coming to my way, if the food is not hygienic, and the other source of infections are there, and my body is not getting the nutritious food, I am not doing enough exercise, I am stressed, the immunity level goes down. And in that case, if some infection is coming, this has higher chances of getting converted to disease. So, of course, when we talk about infection to the disease, there are multiple factors which are contributing in the symptoms.
Okay, ma'am, if we talk about immune system here, and because for every disease, be it polio or even for COVID-19 these days, we are taking vaccines, and we are saying that if someone's immune system is strong, then he or she may not get infected by COVID-19, and that this is what happens with every disease. So how does a vaccine exactly works? Can you throw some light on this?
Thank you, Tanvi ma'am. This is a very, related and pertinent question. And in today's context, all the more this is important, because these days we've been hearing a lot about vaccination. Everybody is asking each other, have you been vaccinated? And the government is also encouraging us to get vaccinated against the COVID-19 virus. So this is a very important question, and certainly I'm going to take it up. So, ma'am, after 1 or 2 minutes, I'm going to take your question.
Okay.
First, let's understand how do we treat, what are the principles of treatment, okay? So when I say principles of treatment, this is the foundation of treatment. Means, it may be like, you know, 2 ways. One is that I see some signs and symptoms and I'm trying to control the intensity of that disease by taking, let's say, I'm sleeping for some time, or I'm taking some painkiller, or I'm taking some medicine which is lowering down the temperature in case of fever. So this is something which I'm trying to minimize the effect. I'm trying to control the effect. This is one way of treatment. The other way is that, because in the first way I'm trying to minimize it, control it, but the microbe is there, the positive agent is there. The second way is to kill. So when we talk about killing about the microorganism, we have already talked about the usage of antibiotics. Because antibiotics work in the specific biochemical processes of certain organisms, certain group of organisms. So it becomes easier to kill that particular microorganism if we have specific antibiotics against that. Apart from that, there are specific medicines for, let's say, when there are intestinal worms, when some Escherichia infection is there, which is the most common infection found in the children. We have seen the children develop intestinal worms. So this is basically Escherichia, which is called by and there are medicines against that also, which kills the Escherichia. So the second principle of treatment is killing the microbes. Now, let's talk about principles of prevention. Okay, so one thing which is very important, students, is that we talk about infection, we talk about haplotype disease, we talk about treating it. But it is always said, and you have been hearing it, I'm sure, the prevention is better than cure. Why? The reason is that once you get infection, then of course it is going to affect your body. It is going to go to certain organs, certain tissues, certain organ systems, and it is going to create some damage. Now, if there is a loss of time in the treatment, for example, we come to know about some disease after a long period of time, then already damage is done. So if you give some medicine, it may save your life, it may treat you, but the damage which has been done to the organs, it is there. So it is always good that we should prevent from the exposure. And how can we do that? Very simple. First thing is that maintaining the personal and community hygiene. I need to maintain personal hygiene for myself, means cleaning everything, washing my hands and other things, eating the hygienic food, ensuring the pure and clean drinking water. Apart from that, I should also take care of the community hygiene. For example, in case of malaria and dengue, the mosquitoes, they get multiplied if we are not controlling the hygienic conditions of the community. So we don't have to let the water be standing for a long period of time. And through these means, we may prevent the exposure. Number one. Apart from that, there is also a fighting against, which we have just talked, immune system. So we to maintain healthy lifestyle, to take minimum required number of enough sleep, so that we are fit, our immunity is high, it is strong. And when, by chance, if some infection is there, it is not getting converted into this. So this is very, very important. First, preventing the exposure. Second, increasing your immunity. And this is also the one thing that I was talking about. Then when you talk about prevention and exposure, you can prevent it. For example, if it is airborne disease, then you should avoid going to crowded places like the case of the COVID-19 pandemic. If it is waterborne disease, then of course we need to ensure the safe drinking water. If it is vector-borne disease like malaria and dengue, then of course we need to maintain the clean hygienic surrounding and we should not let the water be stagnated for a long time. So this is a key to stop the spreading of infectious disease is the preventing the exposure and cleaning and maintaining the hygiene in our surrounding. Now let's come to the second, which is Tanvi ma'am, I will be answering your question. Now I am talking about immune system with the students. As I just said, immune system in a simple way, it is the fighting mechanism of the body. It has various fluids, liquids, and it has lymph, it has different specific cells in our body. And this helps us fight off the infection at the first stage. So if any microorganism is getting reaching to me, I'm getting exposed to any microorganism, my immune system is supporting me. It's like, you know, helping me fight off that infection. So one thing which we can do, I have just said that we have to increase the immunity of the body, which is if infection is not. But second thing, which is vaccination, which Tanvi ma'am had raised the question, is also very important. See, let's understand what is the mechanism of vaccination. So students, in immunity, we have seen that there are certain cells in our body. If some infection comes to us, some, let's say, virus is coming to me, my body is getting exposed to it. In first go, it fights the virus, we recover, it takes a longer period of time to recover. But once we are recovered, our body maintains the memory of this fight. We remember that antigen, that virus which had come to me. So this is the specific quality of dependent cells which create a memory, which are known as memory cells also, which are there in our body. So in case if you have developed good memory cells in your body, then next time when the infection will come, your body will be ready to fight it off with more vigor, more intensity, more food.
Absolutely.
So this is the basic foundation of vaccination. Okay. That is why we say we need to have vaccination, because it is going to help us in fighting the disease.
Absolutely. And ma'am, we don't have any more time left, so we'll have to wrap up this session. But thank you for the...
I will just take 2 minutes. This is my last slide which is going on. And in this, I would like to tell students, because this is the last chapter. So this is the last slide which I'm discussing.
Ma'am, can you make it brief? We don't have... Thank you so much, ma'am, for being here, for talking about the immunization and talking about the importance of vaccine. Thank you once again. Thank you to all the students for watching this entire session. I'm sure you loved it. And because she highlighted the importance of vaccine, now you know that we need to get ourselves vaccinated. And if you haven't till date, please register yourself and get yourself vaccinated and stay safe from COVID-19. Thank you so much for joining us, and keep on watching our NCERT official, our YouTube channel and our PME Vidya channels. Coming up next is our special program webinar, where we'll have a panel discussion on digital games for education. Thank you. Stay with us. Namaskar.